Yes, welcome to this evening's SPCL Vcast. I'm very glad that we could convince an old friend, Gerhard, to tell us more about an old problem with new solutions, I'm hearing. So Nikolai is going to introduce him, and then we'll get started right away.
Thank you, Torsten, and thank you, Gerhard, for agreeing to give a talk. Gerhard is a professor for high performance computing in the Department for Computer Science at the University of Erlangen-Nuremberg in Germany, where he heads the HPC division at the Erlangen Regional Computing Center, among other positions. He received his PhD in theoretical physics from the University of Bayreuth and has been involved in HPC research and teaching for more than 20 years now. With that, we'll let Gerhard talk about sparse matrix vector multiplication. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for the introduction. Thanks a lot, Torsten, for inviting me to your seminar. In times like these, it is good to stay in contact to foster and keep up the scientific exchange. And I'm really happy that I can talk about an old problem in general, and also an old problem for me, because I started with that computational problem when I did my PhD in theoretical physics. So you know, many problems in theoretical physics, in quantum physics, are sparse problems. And so I'm now working with sparse matrices for more than 30 years, 25 years. Okay, so most of the work I present here is not work of mine, as we all know. So most of the work has been done by a young and talented PhD student, Christy Louis Allapart, and he also received several awards already for the work I'm going to present here. But let's put the work into context. Let's start with a short motivation. So sparse matrix vector multiplication, to be more specific, the multiplication of a sparse matrix with a dense vector is basically a widespread kernel operation in many numerical algorithms. And it's the core component of applications in quantum physics and quantum chemistry. Nowadays, also some applications in quantum computing are require this kind of operations. It's also widespread in engineering, in CFD, in structural mechanics, and also to mention also new application fields, it is used in clustering algorithms to cluster sets of data. It's widespread, it's computational intensive, it requires a lot of resources. For that reason, we have a lot of vendor optimized libraries available. So the sparse matrix vector multiplication routine that is available in Intel MKL, in NVIDIA QSparse, in Sparse Magma, in many libraries. You can just link that library and use it out of the box. So in this talk, I will concentrate on node level implementations of sparse matrix vector multiplication. So we don't do any distributed parallelization. We just do threaded parallelization on a single node. And we assume large matrices. That means the size of the matrix is at least sufficiently larger than the outer level cache sizes. This is what we call a large matrix nowadays. So let's start with this very basic operation. So here you can see the multiplication of a sparse matrix. So the non-zero elements of this matrix are labeled with red boxes, with the dense right-hand side vector B, resulting in an updated left-hand side vector C. As you can see here, this basic kernel operation is easy to parallelize. You could just parallelize over the rows as there are no dependencies, input-output dependencies here. It is also known that this basic operation is strongly memory bound. It has a high code balance, a low computational intensity. And the major problem from the beginning of this basic kernel is the irregular data structure in A. We must cope with this irregular data structure leading to irregular accesses at least in the vector B. To prevent from irregular accesses to the matrix elements of A, many sparse data formats have been introduced and proposed to have a minimum storage overhead for the irregular data structure A and to keep the access to these elements of my A or to the non-zeros of A contiguous. So on the CPU side, the most widely used data format for sparse matrices is the so-called compressed row storage format, which we will use here in this talk. We will see that at least in this context, the data format we choose here is fine for CPUs. You may know coordinate format on GPU side. You may know LPEC or hybrid format. So a few years ago, also my group started to introduce hybrid formats, which can be adapted to CPUs and GPUs requirements. And to give you an idea about the complexity of that world and that I don't want to go into detail here, I would like to refer to a review article from Filippone from 2017, who listed and introduced and investigated all GPU formats known at that time. And this review article is something like 40 pages and it only focuses on GPU format. So we stay with this sparse data format CRS, even though there's a wide variety, but for our purpose today, this is fine. So as I mentioned, this is a high, problem with high computational balance. So it will be on most architectures limited by main memory bandwidth. That means to improve the performance of our kernel operation, of our sparse matrix vector multiplication, we must try or find ways to reduce the overall traffic between main memory and the outer level cache of our processor chip. And there are several directions which you may go to improve that, to improve the code balance. And many of you may know them. I just summarize them to put our work into context. So one way is if you, when you realize that you have a high code balance in the SPMV and you cannot do anything about the SPMV, you could try to find memory bound operations close to the SPMV kernel and fuse this additional vector operation, for example. For example, here in this HPCG algorithm, you could put together the SPMV shown in line 7 of this pseudocode with the scalar product computation or the dot product computation, which takes the result of the SPMV and multiplies it with the input of the SPMV. This way, if you put those two together in a special kernel, in a tailored kernel, you could save the additional load operations, data transfers to P and AP in that at that point here, improving the overall code balance of the algorithm. Of course, this is highly algorithm specific, this approach. And if you do that, you may need to write your own algorithm tailored kernels and can no longer rely on vendor optimized general libraries. Another way, which is also possible for several classes of algorithm, is that you apply the sparse matrix not to a single vector, but to a block of vectors getting a block of results. So typically you can apply that in subspace algorithms where you have a large subspace like in eigenvalue computations, and you have to apply this matrix to all the members of the subspace. So this has this potential has already been realized very early. So a paper to PAR-CFT 1999 is the first one who pointed out the possibilities to improve the code balance in that algorithm. And you may all know at least two of the authors of that paper. So Bill Grob and David Keith. Another way is to combine those two algorithms. And this is what we have done in recent years, for example, for a Chebyshev filter computation for blocks of inner eigenvalues, where you can put together by designing special kernels, different steps of the algorithm into a single kernel, avoiding data transfers, and you can improve substantially the balance of the subspace algorithm by doing applying the matrix once to all vectors. So if you're interested in that, I refer to those papers. In this talk, I would like to go back to general considerations, which are not, at least in the beginning, algorithm dependent. In the beginning, I would like to come back to an old problem that is symmetric sparse matrix vector multiplication. Many problems in physics, in chemistry, in engineering are symmetric. That means it would be sufficient to store only the upper or lower half of the matrix and apply it to the vector to save data transfers to main memory and improve the code balance. However, so far we haven't found any valuable, any usable implementation in the kernel libraries which can boost appropriately this baseline operation. The problem here is efficient parallelization. I will come back to that in a few minutes. And the second problem I would like to address at the end of the talk with some preliminary results is cache blocking for sparse matrix power kernels. So you apply a power of the matrix A to a vector X and store it in a vector Y. This kernel, this kind of operation is required when you calculate matrix polynomials or can be used when you use asynchronous Kryloff methods, for example. The problem here is how can we make use of the data locality in basically what is a sparse matrix multiply here. So we cannot expect we can do A square highly efficient with dense matrix in the same way as we can do it with sparse matrices. And we come back that we can make new contributions to those old problems by using our so-called recursive algebraic coloring engine. This is an approach to get hardware efficient colorings of the underlying graph problem and get reasonable, appropriate levels of parallelism out of the problem to match the parallelism in the hardware. So this is basically what I would like to discuss in that talk now. So the agenda is very briefly, I would like to show you that we can describe most of these effects with simple performance models based on simple optimistic assumptions on the code balance. So I put that here, I will be very brief. The reason is because I see many sparse matrix vector literature on performance issues, which never even tried to do a performance estimate, but this is doable. And these performance models will guide all our investigations later on. Then I would like to introduce what is the problem for symmetric SPMB, what are typical solutions nowadays? And then I would like to introduce rays in the context of the symmetrical SPMB problem and show that we can achieve with rays on a wide range of problems, speed ups in terms of performance, which you would expect from the decrease in code balance. And then, as I mentioned already, I will also give an outlook how you can apply this idea to calculate efficiently sparse matrix powers. So let's start. Our performance model approach, of course, is a roofline type approach. You may remember the performance of a kernel, if it's heavily memory bound, this is what we assume here, according to roofline model is the computational intensity of the code times the main memory balance BS here, and the computational intensity for some historic reasons, we use the balance, the code balance, which is related to the intensity by its inverse. So this is nothing new. So roofline model and roofline like modeling approaches are very old, very established. Also estimating or giving limits for the code balance is nothing new. So as I mentioned, it already appears in the paper of Bill Grob and David Keyes, and we also did some work in that context. So just to give you an idea how simple it is to get a useful code balance for this complex sparse matrix vector multiplication in CRS format. This is basically the CRS implementation of sparse matrix vector. The green data structures here are used to represent the matrix entries and the column indices. Then there's a row pointer, which we also need to recover the elements of A. And then we have these two vectors, C and B, and NR and NC are the numbers of rows and the number of columns in the matrix, and N and Z, this number here, is the total number of non-zero elements in the matrix. So how to calculate a code balance? Code balance means how much data do I need to transfer to perform a certain amount of flops? And the simplest approach to estimate the data transfer is just count the overall data set size and assume that every element of this data set size is exactly used once, with one exception. With C, the data element of C is used twice, load and store. And this is what we do here. And this is how we get our first estimate for the minimum code balance. So we just add up all those data set sizes. We count the access to C twice as we load and store. And we divide by the total number of flops, which is 2 times the number of non-zeros of the matrix. And this is the minimum code balance based on no measurement, just qualitative numbers from the matrix. We can make this nicer, this formulation, by dividing by the number of non-zeros. And then we here get some correction factors which represent the sparsity of the matrix, numbers of non-zeros per row in average, and numbers of non-zeros per column in average. But the important point here is that the absolute minimum code balance of that operation is 6 bytes per flop. And this you should remember whenever you see sparse matrix vector multiplication performance numbers. You should remember that number. This is really light speed code balance. So far, we have only considered that we load every element of B only once. However, you know, the sparsity structure irregularly accesses B, and if we have some additional data traffic, then this will result from this irregular access to B. The impact of this irregular access to B is an intricate interplay of the cache sizes and the data structure and the size of the vectors. This cannot be modeled analytically or a priori. We can measure that, so we introduce now a parameter alpha, which we measure indirectly, which quantifies the cost in data of data transfer, the cost in data of code balance of the irregular access to our vector, right-hand vector B. And how to get to this alpha in the following, I will only use a quadratic matrices, so NNZC and NNZR are equal. We can measure this factor alpha as we can measure the code balance. The actual code balance is the overall volume we need in the sparse matrix vector multiplication, data volume. This can be measured, for example, using the liquid tool. And we divide it by the actual flops performed, which we know analytically. And this measured code balance should be our model code balance. And from that, we can determine alpha. And this is how we determine BC of alpha, which I show later on. And from that, we can calculate the performance of the sparse matrix vector multiplication. If you are interested in that and impacts of alpha and discussion of alpha, come to our node-level performance engineering tutorial, which we present several times a year. We have a slot of 30 to 45 minutes discussing on that model there. But have in mind, we can model that, and this is what I present here. Here we did several larger matrices from different collections. This is performance on a single 24-core socket of a Cascade Lake processor. This bandwidth measured for that socket is 122 gigabytes per second. Remember, the absolute minimum balance is 6 bytes per flop. That means the maximum performance we get on that machine, if all data comes from memory for the matrix, is 20, just above 20 gigaflops. And you see that is our upper limit for all the measurements here. There are only two exceptions here. And the reason you see here, this is basically the measured code balance PC of Alpha. Here, the matrices, those two are so small that at least parts of them fit into the outer level cache. However, for all other matrices, you see that our 6 bytes per flop is an upper limit. We can improve the performance model. This is our BC min, the analytic model, no measurement. And you see that the blue curve representing this model matches very well to most of the measurements, which are shown in green. And for those who deviate from blue, we find that this additional traffic to the right-hand side, the vector by measuring the alpha, can close the gap. And you see that we can accurately model and understand the performance characteristic of the sparse matrix vector multiplication for those matrices. Can we extend to GPU? Basically, yes, but only on a very coarse level right now. Basically, I've shown here some GPU data presented by Hartwig Anz and his group. Please be aware, we should look at this range here of large matrices. This is the number of non-zeros here. The model only works in this regime, maybe 10 million non-zeros or more. And the bandwidth of that machine is 1.4 terabytes per second. This is an E100. Dividing that by 6 gives you an upper performance bound of 233 gigaflops. And you see this is really a light speed bound. So we do not go beyond that. And there are several implementations and different data formats and different matrices which come close to each other. In general, we see that it's harder on a GPU to get to this optimistic limit than on a CPU. But now let's dig into our problem. This is basically symmetric SPMV. So as I mentioned, a serial kernel is simple to implement. We only store the upper triangular, for example, in that example of the matrix. And whenever we update a row, we also update the corresponding matrix entries from the lower triangular. So that means we proceed this way through the matrix. And you see that also the shaded elements, the corresponding shaded elements are updated. And we can also do a code balance for that. And we see that this is the code balance for the symmetric implementation. In best case, we can improve the code balance by a factor of 2. That means we can improve at most the speed of the sparse matrix vector multiplication by a factor of 2. So what is now the problem of parallelization? This is shown here. Basically, if we do just row-wise parallelization, we have two threads. Thread one is calculating these rows. Thread two is calculating those rows. Then we may get in conflict if threads work on rows which share the same column index. So we get a problem here, race condition, right dependencies. Here, for example, in this example, if both work concurrently on these two rows, they will update the same element here. Of course, it is known how to solve this problem with OpenMP programming. There are two typical technical solutions, recommendations to do that. You may lock every entry of the left-hand side vector and release locks to prevent from concurrent updates of different threads. Or you might just use thread local local copies of the result vector of the left-hand side vector C and then do a reduction. This works fine if you have a few threads, but this is not scalable. We did some tests on that. And this is not a good way if you want to get a scalable and low overhead implementation. There are also some data formats proposed, have been proposed, which solve at least some of those problems, like compressed sparse blocks or recursive sparse blocks, but they are very oriented on a geometric decomposition of the matrix, and they still have problems in locking rows and columns for preventing from concurrent overhead, concurrent updates. So our approach looks to parallelize the symmetric SPMB in a different direction. Basically, we consider extracting parallelism for this basic operation to be the problem of graph coloring, achieving a coloring of the underlying graph for my sparse matrix, which allows me concurrent execution of the symmetric sparse matrix vector multiplication. That means a coloring in that context of the underlying graph would achieve that if you do a distance two coloring, you require that for the symmetric sparse matrix vector multiplication for standard coloring algorithm, distance two coloring, that vertices or columns which are in the same color can be calculated in parallel because they have at least two connecting vertices in between, which removes the dependency or prevents from concurrent updates. And the same color matrix entries are consecutive in main memory. There are standard ways to do the coloring of this underlying graph. We have looked at the two most prominent ones, a standard one, this is multicoloring very established, and a more recent one, algebraic block multicoloring introduced by Eva Schieder and his group. And they are commonly used for distance one coloring of Gauss-Seidel or ICCG solver, or for distance two coloring of Kaczmarek solver. And we have just applied this idea of generating parallelism independence on the graph level to parallelize our symmetric sparse matrix vector multiplication. The benefit is that you can just apply to it without changing the data format, no locking or thread private vectors. If you do multicoloring of the problem, assume this is your sparse matrix, multicoloring will, with distance two, will generate three colors. And the colors with the elements of the rows of the same color will be grouped, and within the same color, rows can be executed in parallel as multicoloring puts together structural orthogonal rows into the same color. That means in parallelization, you would have this picture step by step. After each color, you need a synchronization. However, you see that you get a lot of load on the left-hand side vector. With every color, you need to load and store the left-hand side vector, which substantially may increase this alpha factor. And this is what we see if we implement that. This is basically this sparse baseline sparse matrix vector without exploiting the symmetry, exploiting the symmetry with multicoloring approaches. You have a dramatically reduced performance, and you are far away from the roofline limit based on this estimate from the code balance using either load only or a stream-like access main memory bandwidth. So those two ranges come from the different potential bandwidth numbers you can achieve on this architecture. Here we have plotted the code balance of the different approaches, and you see this is a bad matrix. Some alpha factor is above 6 bytes per flop, but you see the code balance of the symmetric implementations are far higher, directly pointing to the problem that you massively load and store the left-hand side vector. So we need to avoid that. And this is basically the idea of the RACE implementation, the RACE approach. So the RACE uses works on the levels of a BFS graph, of a breadth first search on the graph, And these levels are constructed such that it preserves the data locality in the accesses, that it generates sufficient parallelism for the hardware we want to use, and reduces synchronization overheads and can stay with those CRS data types. So we have level construction, then we do a coloring, which is required by the underlying algorithm. Here we can choose what distance one or distance two coloring of our algorithm. It's available for general distance k coloring, and then we do a load balancing, and we can apply that recursively to subgraphs of the problem. We have introduced that in a 35-page journal publication. For that reason, I would like to briefly only sketch the idea. So consider this stencil matrix. So we have some two-dimensional prototype toy asymmetric stencil. The matrix would have off diagonals structure like here. And this matrix can be represented as an undirected graph, as we have a symmetric matrix. For example, here, this would be our row number zero. And this row number zero is connected with row one and column one and column eight. And these are the corresponding vertices here. So that means the stencil is represented in the edges between the vertices of this undirected graph here. I have chosen this simple example for illustration. The method does not depend on any structure in the matrix itself. So what do you do in a BFS? In a BFS, you traverse the graph like follows. Your first level is this element, then the next level is all elements depending on the previous level, and so on. So you just identify different levels in the graph, and within a given level, the vertices only depend on vertices in the previous level. So to get continuous access to these data, you see within a level, you have distributed elements of the matrix. You reorder that matrix entries that such that you have vertices in the same level consecutively numbered and consecutively made memory. What you now should not do to get a distance k coloring now introduce different colors and color the different levels in different colors. What we do here is we form level groups containing at least, to get a distance k coloring, containing at least k levels. In this example here, every level group contains at least or exactly here two levels. And then on top of those level groups, we do a two color coloring like shown here. So we have red level groups and blue level groups. And as in every level group, we have at least in general K levels, the level groups, the different level groups of the same color are also distance k independent. It means if we require distance one or distance two coloring, we just put a sufficient number of levels in such a color, and then we do a simple two color coloring on top of that. And then we can run, for example, if we need distance two coloring, all red level groups on different threads in parallel, as we have resolved the dependencies between the thread, then we synchronize and do all blue level groups in parallel. So this is the way we approach the problem. This can be generalized to k levels and is shown here for distance two. But you see immediately there's a problem, we get load imbalances. So we have different number of vertices in the levels, and as we only require that at least k levels are in a level group, we can solve that problem. If we know how many threads we need to feed, we can make those level groups here, which have low number of vertices in it, larger. And this is the first way to approach the load balancing problem. Do the assignment of levels to level groups such that you have a good balance of the workload between the threads. Of course, this is not always feasible. we can may also have level groups in between, which are really large. And for that reason, we can also apply, as I've shown here, we can apply the same method, the same approach by choosing subgraphs of this graph. For example, these inner level groups are also a subgraph of the graph. And then we apply recursively the method to those subgraphs, getting additional parallelism. For example, in that picture, when we calculate red, then this is assigned to one thread, this is assigned to one thread, this one is assigned to one thread, and this one. And then in addition, we assign these two, these elements to one thread and these elements to one thread. And we calculate these level groups while we do the other arrays. Basically what happens here, this is shown here. We would have 8 threads, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And we have split up those level groups recursively. That means while these stay in their level group computations, these two threads will first calculate these elements and then jump to the next elements in the same level group, while those this thread stays still here and calculate those two. So we are more flexible by adapting to higher levels of parallelism by this recursive application to subgraphs. Okay, so voila, now we apply that and we see that if we parallelize this sparse matrix vector multiplication, we can go substantially below beyond the sparse matrix vector multiplication performance and get close to our roof line limit here. And this is also reflected in the code balance. So this method now achieves the code balance, which we expect from our simple balance model. Okay, so you may ask, how do you compare with Intel or vendor optimized libraries? This is shown here for a wide range of matrices. I have listed, I have given a table with important numbers on these matrices in the slides at the end. What we see here is the race performance in orange. The shaded gray range is our roofline model based on the optimistic and pessimistic memory balance for this machine. The other numbers are different measurements from Intel MKL. We have used the inspector execution mode, the symmetric, the deprecated version, and the baseline SPMV, which does not exploit any symmetry. And we see that we always beat MKL. We also see that MKL actually is not, in most cases, not capable of exploiting the symmetries. And we also see that we are pretty good in the range of the roofline model. That means that in most matrices, there's very little headroom to further improve. This is for an Intel Ivy Bridge architecture. Admittedly, this is really old, low level of degree in parallelism. So we did the same on a more recent architecture. This is 20 core Skylake. And the picture here pretty much is the same. The only exception is that now the Intel library exploiting the symmetry is even worse than the baseline library. So you see that we are on a good path. We have similar results now also for Cascade Lake. We can achieve a speed up of up to 2 for this baseline operation using same data structures as before, no changes, but only some pre-processing of the matrix. Of course, we have also compared with these other coloring approaches, and you see if we compare to multicoloring or algebraic block multicoloring or this data structured, this data block approach, recursive sparse blocks, then we always get at least on par with the performance of those solutions. So this is the minimum speed up we get. 1 means we are on par, above 1 means we are better. So this is the maximum speed up we get on the matrices before, and this is just an average overall speed up. So you see that I think we have found a nice approach to tackle that basic problem of exploiting the symmetry, at least on the node level, in symmetric sparse matrix vector multiplication. The interesting thing is that this level approach of looking at the problem can be used to do some kind of cache blocking for these irregular data structures if you calculate powers of the sparse matrix applied to our given right-hand side vector. That means, for example, if you want to apply A cubed to X, you could basically compute A cubed and then apply it to X. This wouldn't be a good idea because you can fill in the matrix and sparse matrix. Matrix multiplication is not a very well optimizable kernel. Instead, what we consider here or we propose here is that we on level basis pipeline the access of the A's to the X. So we on level basis, when we have calculated AX sufficiently, we apply the next level of A, a previous level of A to get another A applied to the intermediate result and so on. This is really recent work. We haven't published that so far, but we have very promising results. So for that reason, I wanted to show that also in that talk. So let's look at this simple lens-like matrix where we have like a diagonal and then two lenses close to the diagonal. Basically, if you, in almost all codes, we know if you need to calculate A cube X, the traditional approach is you calculate AX, store it on Y1, then you take Y1, apply A, store it on Y2, and so on. That means here you do not exploit the fact that you use the same elements of A three times. You always stream in the matrix data over and over again. This is what we want to avoid. For that reason, we look at the levels of this matrix. For example, in this matrix would have those levels. So the different levels or level groups are shown here in different colors. That doesn't mean that we do a coloring that way here. We just want to show what are the different level groups of our race approach. Well, if we start with this level and apply A, so we have to calculate these elements times all the corresponding elements of the right-hand side vector, and we update the corresponding rows of Y here. Okay, this we can do. Then we proceed just to the next level. We calculate A on that level, for that level. So we get the elements here, and we have to use these here. Once as these levels are at least distance one neighbors to those levels, once we have calculated these two levels, we can calculate A2 for those because all the elements here at most need elements from these computations before. Means now we can update Y to A square for those elements here. And now you see how that proceeds. We just go to the next level, apply A. If we have done that, we take this vector as input for this matrix vector multiplication and bring up the elements here to A square. And so we can just go level by level. And then in the initial step, we do A. On the previous level, we calculate A square. And on the previous level, we can calculate A cube. This requires that for best performance, these three levels or three consecutive levels are always in cache. So this is some condition for the method to work very well. And we know that at least on AMD side now, we have really massively large caches. And here the concept really works very well. So this is just the way we go level by level and always bring the previous levels to the highest potential power we want to calculate. Okay, so this is the way to go. And here are some preliminary results. This is for a 20-core Skylake processor with SNC mode off. So we have the full level 3 cache available. So the blue version shown here is the computation if we do it in this traditional approach. Let's say it here. It's traditional approach I have shown here, where we have a clear limit on the main memory bandwidth. And you also see that clear limit on the main memory bandwidth in the performance data. So this is basically close to 15 to 20 gigaflops, which is 100 gigabyte of main memory bandwidth, which is the dream bandwidth of that architecture. And here we see some speed ups between maybe 3 and 4 and 1.5. But for all matrices which do not fit into the cache, we get speed up with that approach. We see that we can do even better if we have large caches. This is shown here for an AMD Rome processor chip with 32 cores. We have NPS one node. The bandwidth of this chip in NPS one node is close to 120 gigabytes. So we see a hard limit for memory bound cases here at 20 gigaflops. And here we can get decent speed up over for this approach for a wide range of matrix problems. Please note, of course, if data already fits into cache, we may not get a speed up here, because here we introduce some additional overhead, like synchronization between the threads whenever they march to a next level in the underlying graph. So I think this is very promising, and we are in the process of writing up a paper, and that might be helpful for several application fields. As I mentioned before, asynchronous Krylov method or communication avoiding Krylov methods, or for calculating matrix polynomials. So this is already the end of my talk. I hope that I stayed in time. So I think you should have seen that performance modeling of SPMV, at least on CPUs, is doable and really provides useful and upper performance bounds to check whether your measurement returns reasonable results and whether your measurement has room for improvement, your implementation has room for improvement in terms of performance. We have also seen that there's plenty of headroom still in sparse matrix vector multiplication, because very often the sparse matrix vector multiplication is really implemented in its simplest way by assuming a generally structured matrix and assuming that you cannot reuse data across matrix multiplies to the same vector. RAISE is designed to give some improvements here. This is really a hardware approach. Hardware-aware approach to extract sufficient levels of parallelism, at least for CPUs and data localities in these underlying graphs. And the outlook is that we will try to integrate this idea, at least of the kernels of the matrix powers, into distributed memory parallelization. And another new and interesting field is that on the CPU side, we will change the balance on the machine side dramatically by putting the CPUs on HBM. A first glance in that direction is the Fugaku processor A64FX. And here we have already seen, and also did some work on that, that this general law that CRS is fine for CPU-based system may no longer hold. And we are also interested to see how these approaches here with RAISE may work on these architectures. So thanks a lot for your attention. Of course, RAISE is open source, at least the part we have published so far. We are still working on the matrix powers, and we will release also the software for open use when we have published that. And at the end, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I'm open for questions now.
Thank you, Gerhard, for the excellent and very interesting talk. I certainly learned some new ideas about sparse matrix vector multiplication. Before we go to questions, I do want to mention that our next SPCL BCast will be on the 8th of April, the same time slot, where Steve Reinhardt from Microsoft Research will be here.